Very happy to be with you today, having actually flown in from Knossos just yesterday. My subject is Knossos of the Greek period, which basically spans an entire millennium from the traditional dividing line between prehistoric and classical archaeology at around 1100 BC to the Roman conquest of Crete in the first century BC. Taking you through this great time span is a challenge, and I've chosen to present a thematic overview, pulling together archaeological and textual information. The subtitle of my paper, The City of Idomeneus, is intended to juxtapose Greek Knossos with prehistoric Knossos, the latter made famous through Arthur Evans's monumental publication entitled The Palace of Minos. In the period I study, both Minos and the palace are memories of a distant past. In their place, there was a flourishing city, the most prominent one in Crete, and a different mythical figure, Idomeneus, a grandson of Minos. Idomeneus was the mythical leader of the Cretan army which sailed to Troy, along with Agamemnon, Achilles, and the other Greek heroes. Idomeneus was a true leader of the army, renowned for his wisdom and at the same time a very competent warrior. Idomeneus is not a prominent figure in the visual arts of ancient Greece. Yet, he must have been a dominant figure in the collective memory of the Knossians of the historical period. Clear evidence for this is provided by a Hellenistic inscription from Knossos, which celebrates the death of a local warrior in battle and refers to him as sitting along with Idomeneus in the underworld. Likewise, the Greek author Diodorus Siculus records that Knossians of the first century BC made libations over the tomb of Idomeneus, which was marked by an inscribed funerary stele. This evidence suggests that the spirit of Idomeneus was very much present in Knossos of the first millennium BC and make this figure instrumental to our understanding of Greek Knossos, like the figure of Minos has been for Bronze Age Knossos. Our understanding of Greek Knossos relies on the work of several members of the British school at Athens. In studying this period, I'm actually standing on the shoulders of giants. I can only pay tribute to a few of these individuals on this occasion. I start with Humphrey Payne, who produced the first study on Greek Knossos in 1928. Payne was very soon to become the director of the British school, the youngest in the school's history, and gained fame through his study of the art of archaic Athens and Corinth. Before this, however, he was invited by Arthur Evans to excavate some tombs in Knossos. On the basis of his finds and the finds of previous digs by Evans, Payne produced a thorough study of Knossian ceramics from around 1000 to 600 BC. Later, the school considered the possibility of having Payne excavate in Knossos in search for archaic remains. But Arthur Evans argued against this plan, noting that this phase is poorly preserved at the site. Payne would return to Knossos 5 years later to excavate some more tombs of the early first millennium BC. Because of his untimely death, the study of this material was entrusted to James Brock, who had participated in that dig and was later to excavate more in other Greek islands. Helped by his wife, Ursula, Brock produced a magisterial publication of the finds which is still fundamental to the archaeology of Crete. At about the time Brock's fundamental study came out in 1957, a young scholar arrived in Knossos. This was Nicholas Coldstream, who published his first article on a well in Knossos. For the next half a century, a prolific series of articles and books by Colson Wood shed much light on the archaeology of Knossos from the early Iron Age to the Hellenistic period. In a recurring pattern, Nikki Colstrom contributed much to this and Nicholas's wife. Nicholas Colstrom is a key figure for today's event, not only because of his studies, his many studies of Greek Knossos, but also because he held different offices for the British School and also briefly served as an assistant keeper of antiquities in the British Museum. The legacy of Payne, Brock, Colstrom and many other members of the school is fundamental to current research on Knossos. This research, research, however, on Greek Knossos is still facing two major problems. First, it's often overshadowed by work centered on the site's Bronze Age. And second, this phase is not well preserved in most areas excavated so far. Domestic remains are actually found sandwiched between two thick horizons, the late Minoan one and the Roman one. Unlike the Minoan ruins, which are overwhelming in the Knossian landscape, the Greek ones are basically not preserved or remain inaccessible to public and scholars alike. Now, Minoan ruins were visible to the Knossians of the Greek period. Some remains of the palace were still standing, but no significant activity occurred there after the Bronze Age. The testimony of classical authors suggests that later Greeks identified the palace with the house of Rhea, the mother of Zeus. In the southwest part of the palace, a small temple was built in the late 5th century, perhaps the temple dedicated to Rhea. In the immediate periphery of the palace, there were houses already from the beginning of the first millennium BC. And in those early centuries, the Minoan theater was also in use, perhaps by a public assembly of the community. In this and other respects, the Minoan past was very much present in the Greek city. Nonetheless, there was also much change. The Mycenaeans had brought the Greek language to Crete in the mid to late second millennium BC. Yet their dialect is not the same as the Doric dialect found in the inscriptions of archaic and classical Knossos. This fact, along with the occurrence of the names of Dorian tribes in Crete, as well as with some migration stories, have long attracted scholarly attention. Archaeologists have sought to identify the arrival of the Dorians in the archaeological record, though without much success so far. In the case of Knossos, the 11th century is considered to be the possible period for this on account of the changes seen in the domestic and burial record. One or two published houses of this date show an apsidal plan, which is extremely rare in Crete but common in the Greek mainland. Likewise, not a single tomb shows continuity in use from the late Bronze Age to the early Iron Age, and the impression of a turning point is also suggested by the introduction of cremation, which gradually replaced inhumation as the main burial rite at the site. Lastly, a new major cemetery is established to the north of the site at this very time. Important as these developments certainly are, they only amount to a slim basis for identifying migration and understanding the transformation of a pre-Hellenic site into a Doric Greek one. The establishment of a major new cemetery is interesting in other respects as well. Much attention has been devoted to the earliest burials found there. This occupy a central position in what was to become the most prominent and extensively used cemetery of Knossos. The burials in question were found in a tomb with three chambers. One of the chambers was found empty. The second contained the cremated remains of an adult female furnished with gold and other jewelry. The last chamber contained the remains of an adult male, an adult female, and perhaps a small child furnished with rich offerings such as weapons and a bronze Cypriot stand. Hector Catling and other scholars have shown that the male warrior burial conveys Homeric overtones and finds parallel elsewhere in mainland Greece and Cyprus of the same period. To the existing analysis of these tombs, I wish to present to you some additional points which place them better within the Knossian context. Most of the arms and weapons which accompanying the burial in tomb 201 are widely found in other Knossian tombs of the Iron Age. There are a few oddities, however. The first one regards the sizable number of arrowheads found. Although more than 100 Knossian Iron Age tombs are known, none presents a comparably rich collection of arrowheads. The arrows represented were probably kept in a quiver made of perishable material, but decorated in bone inlay. This is a very rarely seen piece of equipment, an artifact only known from a single other Cretan tomb of the period. More exceptional even is the fragmentary boar tusk helmet found in this Knossian burial. Such helmets are known from the Aegean of the Bronze Age, but this is the latest one we know. Evidently, the individual buried in the tomb in question was accompanied by exceptional military equipment. Significantly, this equipment is very similar to that carried by a specific Knossian hero of the Iliad. This hero is Meriones, who was a deputy of Idomeneus, according to Homer. In the epic, Meriones is a combatant killer, like many other Greek leaders. Unlike them, however, he is one of the two Greek heroes that use not only the spear, but also the bow, which is a rather inappropriate weapon for a mainstream Achaean hero. We hear more about Meriones' equipment in Iliad Book 10, when the hero hands this gear to Odysseus for a night raid against the Trojans. According to the description, Meriones carries a bow and a quiver, a sword and a boar's tusk helmet. Clearly, this gear basically matches the one found in tomb 201. By pulling these two pieces of evidence together, I'll resist any claim that the mythical Meriones lies buried in that tomb. No. Instead, I wish to argue that the correspondence between the poetic persona of the Knossian hero of the Iliad and the identity assumed by a prominent Cretan Knossian male in the 11th century suggests the currency of certain concepts over Cretan warriors in early Greek times. At the same time, this correspondence suggests to me that Crete described in the Iliad best reflects not Mycenaean Crete of the previous centuries, of the 15th and 14th centuries, but that of the 12th and 11th centuries BC. It is unfortunate we know little about the city of Knossos at this time. Nonetheless, the research surface survey of the site by the Knossos Urban Landscape Project has shed light. It now appears that the settlement of Knossos shrank considerably in the last few centuries of the second millennium BC, but retained an urban nucleus in the area surrounding the palace. This is in marked contrast with what is seen in other major Greek sites like Athens or Argos, which are scattered in hamlets in this very period. The surface survey at Knossos also suggests that from the 10th and 9th centuries BC, the city was expanding considerably, particularly towards the north. Nicholas Kolstrom estimated, on the basis of excavation data, that the extent of the settlement was considerable in the early Greek period. The surface survey suggests it may have been three times as large. The prosperity of early Greek Knossos is also suggested by the finds from its cemeteries. In the middle of the 11th century, in the heart of the so-called Dark Ages of Greece, Knossos enjoyed connections extending as far as Cyprus. From the 10th century, finds come for even, become even more abundant and include bronze vessels from Egypt and the Levant. Notice that the bronze bowl shown carries a line of marks. This is actually the earliest alphabetic inscription known from the Aegean and dates from around 900, more than a century before all other alphabetic inscriptions in the Aegean. Yet this inscription is not in Greek, but in Phoenician, and records the name of the submitting owner of the bowl. The mechanism that brought this bowl to Knossos is unclear, but its discovery in a tomb that produced a score of pottery from Attica hints at the development of an eclectic attitude towards foreign commodities. This attitude culminates in the late 9th century and manifests itself in a flamboyant pottery style, which blends the local tradition with the Attic ceramic style, the style of Oriental bronzes, and the Minoan figural repertory. During this time and throughout the 8th century, the external context of Knossos extend from Luristan in the area of modern Iran in the east to the western Mediterranean island of Sardinia. There is no other site in the Aegean of this period that shows a comparable range of contacts. So keep in mind that Greek Knossos was no less cosmopolitan than its Minoan predecessor. Unlike their Minoan forefathers, however, the Knossians of the early Greek period were not keen in exporting their products overseas. They did export, however, within the island. The Knossian ceramic style affected much of north-central Crete and some sites in south-central Crete, while smaller group of exports occurred from the east to the central-west part of the island. However, unlike in Minoan times, the extensive impact of the Knossian style is not taken by scholars to reflect political authority. Turning back to overseas connections, I note that the Knossians were not only importing foreign commodities, but also attracted foreign merchants and craftsmen. A case in point is provided by the evidence from a large tomb which was exceptionally rich in gold. Sir John Boardman interpreted the find as a Near Eastern foundation deposit and attributed the jewelry to a goldsmith from North Syria who migrated to Knossos. Although attractive and popular, Boardman's idea has been questioned. The find is better seen as a hoard of the elite patron of the craftsman, who was also controlling the distribution of precious commodities in the Knossian society. Another possible case for Near Easterns in Knossos is raised by a fairly standardized class of juglets. Some of these juglets come from Cyprus and were reaching Knossos in considerable numbers, and they instigated a long and prolific production of a local series. Nicholas Goldstream has interpreted these Knossian pots as products made to order for the bottling of unguents produced by a small factory manned by immigrant Phoenicians. More convincing evidence for the burial of Near Eastern immigrants in Crete has come up in recent years. This evidence regards one or two peculiar stone grave markers which have no local or Aegean pedigree, but find close parallels in the Phoenician and Punic grave stealer. This monument suggests that Phoenicians were living in Iron Age Knossos and were obviously integrated into the local community. This picture of 9th and 8th century Knossos as a cosmopolitan hub recalls the picture given for Crete in Homer's Odyssey. Sue Serrat has drawn attention to the fact that in this epic, Crete has a special profile which is characterized by close contact with the Phoenicians, while its inhabitants are portrayed as maritime opportunists, particularly aggressive and bellicose. This profile of Knossos and Crete is transformed in the course of the 7th century. The Near Eastern links wane and the island returns to an Aegean, particularly Peloponnesian orbit, and remains there for the rest of Greek antiquity. This rehabilitation of the Knossians and other Cretans can also be read in a literary account of the same period, the 7th century. This text is the Homeric hymn to the Pythian Apollo, which narrates how the god led a ship with Knossian merchants to Delphi and made them his priests. The story is no doubt a mythical one, but one cannot help reading in it the deeper integrations of the Cretans in the Greek culture. The story of the Homeric hymn can also be connected with the discovery of some splendid Cretan bronzes in Delphi of the 7th century. Cretan exports, which were previously very rare, now make a notable appearance in different places. It is unclear if these exports are specifically Knossian, but it is unlikely that the capital city was unaffected by the new exchange network. Cretan pottery reached the other major sanctuary of Apollo on the Cycladic island of Delos, and also found its way to the sanctuary of Aphrodite in the island of Thera. This island, which lies close to Crete, has also produced few Cretan Daedalic sculptures of small size and shows even deeper cultural connections with Crete, a bit like in the Bronze Age. The story of colonization of Cyrene in Africa also links Crete and Thera in the 7th century, and this is also the time that Rhodians and Cretans established the colony of Gela in Sicily. It is unclear whether Knossians were among the Cretan colonists, but Knossos shows an increased connection with the Aegean and particularly with the Peloponnese, manifested among other evidence by the importation of Corinthian pottery. The same pattern is seen elsewhere in Crete, and this suggests that the Peloponnese is henceforth also established as the main source of ceramic imports. Metalwork also shows Peloponnesian influence, while stone, a terracotta sculpture of the 7th century, conforms to the Daedalic style, which spreads over much of the southern Aegean. In short, from the 7th century, Crete turned its back to the Mediterranean after approximately three centuries of regular interaction with the Near East. The island was absorbed into Aegean networks while its material culture was fully Hellenized and, from the end of the 7th century, increasingly impoverished. The impoverished material culture does not imply that Cretans were impoverished at the time. The huge storage pithy, which are so typical for the island's archaic period and recall their Minoan predecessors, do not suggest pottery, but huge agricultural surplus. Yet the traditionalism of Cretan society and the conservative socio-political regime left little space for overseas trade and had no need for the competitive display which then generated some of the marvels of archaic Greece, like the Symposium and its visual and literary culture or monumental architecture and sculpture. But the picture was perhaps less unimpressive than we currently think. The beautiful head of a late archaic statue was discovered a few years ago in Knossos and points to conspicuous display familiar from much of the Greek world. Understanding late archaic and classical Knossos is not easy. We lack the historical accounts available for other major Greek cities. We do know, however, that Knossos was run by aristocrats, like other Cretan cities, and never developed democracy. According to one tradition, Knossos was the hometown of Epimenides, a famous wise man of archaic Greece who was summoned by Greek cities for advice and purification. Likewise, two Knossian architects are famous for having worked in the monumental temple of Artemis in Ephesus, in Asia Minor. As for political history, we know that in the 11th century, the Knossians and other Cretans asked the oracle at Delphi about joining the rest of the Greeks against the Persians. The oracle was openly negative, hence the Cretans did not contribute to the well-known Greek triumphs in the Persian Wars. A few years after these wars, the Knossos faced internal strife. The poet Pindar narrates that the noble Ergoteles, a distinguished long-distance runner who was soon to become an Olympic victor, had to leave Knossos because of that strife. The Golden Age of Greece, the 5th century, is unimpressive at Knossos. The extent of the classical city is schematically rendered on the screen. We do not know the exact location of the agora, but this was probably located somewhere in the northern part of the city. The Acropolis of the ancient city was on the hill of Monastriaki Kefala, but it remains unclear whether Knossos was protected by defensive walls. Sporadic finds suggest that the city was encircled, however, by cemeteries, with tombs concentrated particularly to the north, towards the sea. We know more about sanctuaries, though the temple of the Polyad deity, namely Apollo, eludes discovery. Big monuments are missing, but there are promising chance finds, like this metop showing Heracles and the wild boar. As I've already said, a small temple, probably dedicated to Rhea, was built on the southwest part of the Minoan palace. A small building, actually, a hero shrine, is located further west. It is attributed to the local hero Glaucus and produces offerings, perhaps used in rites of passage. Immediately south of the city is an old sanctuary which was embellished with a temple at around 400 BC. Terracottas, lamps, and two inscribed rings confirm that the deity worshipped was Demeter. Lastly, a few weeks ago, the public was informed by the discovery of a new sanctuary in the eastern part of the territory of Knossos. This sanctuary was tentatively attributed to Artemis, but I'm not convinced and prefer to identify it with the sanctuary of Hera mentioned by the author Diodorus Siculus. This suggestion best accords with the evidence available. First, the identified foundations of a large temple echo the descriptions of Diodorus. Second, the river which passes by the sanctuary has already been identified with the river Thirin, which, according to Herodotus, ran by the temple of Hera. Ancient authors mention that in the late classical and Hellenistic periods, Knossos was very busy expanding her territory and fighting other Cretan cities in all directions. In the mid-4th century, the Knossians, aided by mercenaries, took the rival city of Lyktos, but were forced to withdraw by the powerful Spartans. The might of Knossos was even greater in the 3rd century when the city headed a group of Cretan states in a largely anti-Macedonian alliance. Towards the end of that century, the Knossians recaptured their old enemy Lyktos and carried away the women and children. But as Knossos grew, the city of Gortyn in the south also did so, and in the early 2nd century BC, the Knossians were defeated by the Gortynians and lost territories in the south. Nonetheless, Rome, which was emerging as a global power, intervened in favor of Knossos and ensured that the lost territories were returned. In the next decades, Knossos and Gortyn joined forces in eliminating smaller cities in central Crete and appropriated great territorial units. But Knossos was actually also losing power in relation to Gortyn. All these wars make the Cretans famous as mercenaries and pirates, and this expertise of theirs lies behind the humiliating defeat they inflicted under the direction of a Knossian on a Roman fleet in 71 BC. The Romans were soon to return, Knossos was besieged, and 4 years later the entire island was subdued to the might of Rome. And it was Gortyn, not Knossos, that was chosen as the capital of the Roman province on Crete and Cyrene. But this brings me to the end of my story. And before I pass the floor to Professor Wall, I would like to go over major points raised already. Contrary to general assumption, the collapse of the palaces and the end of the Bronze Age did not involve the dwindling of Knossos into insignificance. In the first 4 centuries of the first millennium BC, Knossos is a very prosperous urban center and one of the most populous sites in the Aegean. Its contacts extend as far as the Minoan contacts had reached in the Bronze Age. Admittedly, however, most of the sea traffic directed to Knossos in the Greek period was not in Knossian hands, but in that of foreigners. It is these foreigners that make the site one of the most cosmopolitan places of early Greece. This picture gradually changes in the 7th century, at which point Knossos and Crete in general is marginalized from a Mediterranean network and is increasingly driven into its Aegean context and turned into a periphery. Knossos of the classical and Hellenistic period is probably the largest and strongest city in Crete, but is no longer in the forefront of cultural developments in ancient Greece and the Aegean. Moreover, it increasingly engages in war with other Cretan cities, adhering to the warlike spirit of the mythical king Idomeneus. It is the ebb and flow of Greek Knossos which makes it such an interesting place to study, a true labyrinth like the one struck on her coins. Thank you very much.